welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, you will hear stories from John Russell and Jill Robbins. Later, Bryan Lynn presents this week's science report. We close the show with the lesson of the day from Jill Robbins and Andrew Smith. But first,
Camille Stevens Roman recently sat on the ground and measured small trees to see how much they had grown in 7 months. She found they had grown 5 to 10 centimeters. Her team had planted several different kinds of trees, known as evergreens, 2 years ago in an area of the Rocky Mountains in Colorado, which had burned in a fire in 2020. Stevens Roman and other researchers want to learn the relationship between tree growth and elevation. Researchers say there are not enough small trees or seeds from living trees to replace burned trees. Even if there were enough, they say the U.S. does not have the workers to plant and care for them. The Forest Service said the biggest delays they meet while replanting on public land are preparing environmental and cultural studies and preparing burned areas so they are safe to plant. That can take years. Stevens Roman said, "We're in a place of such drastic climate change that we are not talking about whether or not some of these places will be a different kind of forest, but whether or not they will be forest at all." In the past, the U.S. was able to replant burned forests. But the researchers say larger, more intense fires are destroying trees that normally provide seeds. They say the fires leave burn scars so large, trees cannot naturally regrow. Solomon Z. Dabrowski is a University of Montana forest management expert. He said more areas in the West need replanting after fires than can be replanted. He said at least 1.5 million hectares need to be replanted, but officials are unable to do so. He said that number could triple by 2050. Matthew Herto is a forest ecologist at the University of New Mexico. He studied the way scarred forests had been replanted after a fire in 2011 at Los Conchas. That fire destroyed huge areas of ponderosa pine trees. Herto found most of the seedlings, or very young trees, had died from earlier replanting. As a result, he planted seedlings of different species at several elevations and on hillsides facing different directions. Now he is watching carefully for changes in the soil and water. Researchers say seedling survival is less likely at lower elevations. It is hotter, drier, and more open there. Replanting the same trees in the same areas is likely to fail. Jason Sieg is acting supervisor of the Arapaho and Roosevelt National Forests and Pawnee National Grassland. He said the Forest Service rules require planting the same species at the same elevations as before a fire. But, he said, it is clear the agency will need to be flexible moving forward. For now, that might mean replanting at different elevations or collecting seeds from another place. Over time, researchers say it could require planting trees that are not native to the area. The idea has been debated, but is gaining support. I've seen people go from saying, absolutely, we cannot move trees around, to, well, maybe let's try it at least, and do a few experiments to see if this will work, said Stevens Ruman. Environmental groups are working on private land burned by the Cameron Peak fire. They are replanting ponderosa pines 150 meters higher than where they used to grow, said Megan Maiolo Heath. Maiolo Heath is a spokesperson for the Coalition for the Poudre River Watershed. So far, 84% of trees planted there last year are still alive. The Forest Service is modernizing how it grows young trees. It is also studying ways to grow more or work with private industry, states, and groups like the New Mexico Reforestation Center. Experts say trees might never return to some areas, but it is important that the U.S. does as much as possible in a thoughtful way. Trees live for hundreds of years, so we need to be thinking about what's right as we plant trees today, Horto said. I'm Jill Robbins.
In the Japanese town of Kojima, the main road is named Jean Street. This street is where people from around the world come to visit. The drink machines at the train station have images of jeans on them. The roads are painted blue, with the lines at the edges colored pink and white. The trademark of Kojima Jeans seems. With about 40 jeans manufacturers and stores, including cafes, the area gets about 100,000 visitors a year, the Japan National Tourism Organization said. Japanese jeans are often costly, dark, and durable. Although a small part of the global jeans market, Japanese jean makers have developed a reputation for quality and attention to detail. Kojima is where popular brands like Big John are made. The city now supplies international clothing brands, including Gucci. Emma McClendon of St. John's University in New York said that the Japanese industry has not taken a mass marketing path. Instead, the jean industry pays careful attention to creating quality products that collectors might like. In Kojima, Jean Street is small and uncrowded. Each company in the area is small, hiring about 100 people. What you will find are workers taking pride in monozukuri, or making things. The term suggests careful attention to detail. This idea can be found throughout Japan, from car makers to the local tofu store. More like making a kimono is the way Yoshiharu Okamoto, a dyeing craftsman at Kojima-based manufacturer Momotaro Jeans, puts it. His hands and nails are colored blue from putting threads of cotton into a big container of coloring called dye. He knows by smell and feel the right state of the indigo coloring, which he compares to a living thing. He says it is a 365 days a year job, as the dye has to be checked and mixed every day. It's not that easy to get this special color, Okamoto told the Associated Press recently. It's my life. The dark color is so special it has earned the name Japan Blue, or Tokuno Blue, meaning especially concentrated blue. Jeans made in Kojima are costly. The jeans can cost from $230 per pair to $1,400 or more. Tomas Deja Boyer is founder of Denim Hunters, an online site for people who like jeans and the cotton material they are made out of, denim. He says Japanese brands use raw denim that ages well and lasts a long time. He pointed to the jeans as part of a movement known as slow clothing. The idea is to produce fewer, but higher quality pieces of clothing. The movement came as a reaction to low-cost, mass-produced clothes. "We just make too many clothes, I think, and we need to slow down," Boyer said from his home near Copenhagen, Denmark. McClendon said the Japanese industry is shifting the conversation around jeans to be about heritage elements, about educating consumers on historical details as a form of quality. Momotaro jeans, for example, come with a lifetime guarantee. Tears and other problems get fixed at no cost, within reason. Japan Blue Company, which runs Momotaro, a brand that began in 2006, said yearly sales totaled about $11 million for the latest year. About 40% of sales come from outside Japan. Masataka Suzuki, president and chief operating officer at Japan Blue, said the area has a strong industrial history. In the past, industry centered around sewing heavy materials, including military clothes and obi sashes for kimonos, as well as the cotton and indigo dyeing native to the area. "The jeans are for life," Suzuki said. "The jeans slowly change depending on how they are worn and how the wearer lives. We want to create a product that is a testament to a person's life," he said. I'm John Russell.
Scientists have discovered a small asteroid that recently moved closer to Earth's orbit. The object was first observed August 7th by two astronomers from Spain's Complutense University of Madrid. The asteroid, named 2024 PT5, is believed to be about 10 meters long. It usually orbits around the Sun. But Earth's gravitational forces recently pulled the object closer to our planet. Scientists sometimes call such objects mini-moons. This is because they behave similarly to the permanent moon orbiting Earth when they are captured by gravity. But they are much smaller and only temporarily stay in Earth's orbit. The American Space Agency, NASA, said in a statement that 2024 PT5 is not quite a mini-moon because it will never be fully captured by Earth's gravity. However, it described the asteroid as an interesting object the agency plans to follow or track with radar-equipped telescopes. NASA noted the traveling asteroid presented no danger to Earth. NASA and its international partners continuously search the skies for what scientists call near-Earth objects. Such objects include asteroids and comets that come within 50 million kilometers of Earth's orbit. The search system, called ATLAS, involves four different telescopes. Two of the telescopes are based in Hawaii, another operates in Chile, and the other sits in South Africa. NASA explains that ATLAS is designed to search the whole sky several times each night looking for moving objects. 2024 PT5 was identified by the Telescope Observing Station in Sutherland, South Africa. The discovery was made by two astronomers from Complutense University of Madrid, Carlos de la Fuente Marcos and Raúl de la Fuente Marcos. They recently described the find in the publication Research Notes of the American Astronomical Society. The Spanish astronomers said it appeared 2024 PT5 is part of a group of near-Earth objects belonging to the Arjuna asteroid belt. The objects in this asteroid belt are believed to be surrounding the path followed by the Earth-Moon system, they wrote. Such objects are likely more common than we think, said Richard Binzel, an astronomer at the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, MIT. He was not involved in the latest research. Binzel told the Associated Press, "This happens with some frequency, but we rarely see them because they're very small and very hard to detect." But he noted that in recent years, progress in space observation technologies had made it possible to identify more of these moon-like objects. Binzel added that currently it is not known whether the asteroid broke off from a larger asteroid. He said the space rock might even be a piece of our moon that got blasted out. NASA said such an asteroid could have been created by our moon being struck by an asteroid a very long time ago. One of the discovering scientists, Carlos de la Fuente Marcos, told the AP in an email that because of its size and brightness, 2024 PT5 can only be seen from Earth with special equipment. NASA said teams at the agency's Center for Near-Earth Object Studies are continually tracking the movements of 2024 PT5. The center expects the asteroid to remain at a distance about 9 times farther away from Earth than the Moon. Scientists say it will remain gravitationally linked to Earth until November 25th. NASA plans to use its large Goldstone Solar System radar observer to follow the asteroid. The object is set to make another close pass of Earth in January 2025, when it should stay about 5 times the distance between Earth and the Moon. 2024 PT5 is then expected to turn away from Earth as it continues its orbit around the Sun, NASA said. After that, the asteroid is not expected to pass close by Earth until 2055.
I'm Bryan Lynn.
Bryan Lynn joins me now to talk more about his science report. Hi, Bryan. Thanks for being here.
Of course, Ashley. Glad to be here.
So this week, you reported on an asteroid that recently moved closer to Earth's orbit and is almost behaving like a second moon for our planet. We learned from the report this object is expected to stay gravitationally linked to Earth until late November. How common is it for these objects to affect Earth?
So it really has not been that common for such objects to interact with Earth's gravity. Scientists have identified less than 10 of them during the past 10 years that were considered mini-moons meaning they were completely captured by Earth's orbit. And as was mentioned in the report, NASA does not consider the one linked to Earth currently as a mini-moon, which ends up being temporarily fully captured by Earth's orbit. But the report also states that many near-Earth objects exist in our solar system. At least 34,000 have already been identified, and any of these could end up being gravitationally linked to Earth or turn into mini-moons. And the other reason more of these are being identified today is because of progress in observational technologies.
All right. Thanks again for being here, Bryan, and thanks for answering that question.
Sure, Ashley. Thank you.
My name is Anna Mateo.
My name is Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
You're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
Anna loves to be outside, but she is often too busy at work to enjoy the outdoors. So, in lesson 29 of the series, she is happy to join her coworker, Marcia, who suggests they try to do some work outside.
Hello! In Washington, D.C., there are many places that bring history to life, but people who live here often do not have time to see them. They are too busy with work, like me. Hi, Marcia.
Hi, Anna. Have a seat.
Thanks. This was a good idea. Working outdoors is nice.
Mm-hmm. It is.
Whew. I am tired. Today was a busy day at work, and I still have work to do.
That's too bad.
How are you these days?
I'm really busy too, Anna. Let's get to work.
There are many ways we can talk about being busy. Notice how Anna uses the preposition with after the adjective busy.
They are too busy with work.
We can say we are busy with work, or busy with our jobs, or busy with a project. But when we describe what we are doing, we simply use the ing ending on the verb.
So we can say, I'm busy with work, or we can say, I'm busy working. Here are some other examples.
I'm busy writing my report.
I'm busy these days getting ready for my exam.
These days, I'm busy applying for jobs.
And with past participles that are followed by prepositions such as tired of or worried about, we can simply follow them with a noun or with the ing form of the verb, which is called a gerund. That's spelled G-E-R-U-N-D.
And the gerund works just like a noun. So we can say, I'm tired of work, or I'm tired of working.
We can say, I'm worried about the cost, or I'm worried about spending that much money.
A bit later in lesson 29, Anna and Marcia talk about childhood dreams. They talk about what, when they were children, they hoped to become in the future as adults. Let's listen.
In fact, I wanted to be, don't laugh, President of the United States. Stop! I know, it's a silly childhood dream.
I'm sorry. It's not silly. Guess what I want it to be?
What?
When I was a kid, I studied the stars and planets. I wanted to fly into outer space.
You know, Marcia, childhood dreams are important.
They are, and it's good to remember them.
The word dream can be a noun or a verb. And when it's a verb, it can be followed by two different prepositions.
We use dream of to express what we wanted to become when we were young. And we use the ing gerund after the preposition of. So Anna dreamed of becoming president, and Marcia dreamed of becoming an astronaut.
The other preposition after the verb dream is about. We use about to express a particular subject of our dreams.
For example, I can say, last night I dreamed about Jill's dog.
I hope she was a good girl in your dream.
She was.
When we want to express dreams for our future, we tend to use the preposition about followed by a gerund. For example, we can say,
oh, I dream about going to Paris one day.
Oh, me too, Andrew. Or we could say, we dream about finding a new home for our family. We can also use dreamed about in the same way as dreamed of to talk about childhood hopes.
So, Jill, did you dream about becoming or doing anything in particular when you were young?
I wanted to be an astronaut, too. I cut out all the stories in the paper about the space program, and I watched live as the first humans walked on the moon. But then I found out you had to be a man and in the military, two things I didn't think were possible at the time.
Well, some of those things have changed.
Yeah. And now there are women astronauts who are not necessarily in the military. Andrew, how about you? What were your dreams?
I don't think I had any very specific dreams of what I wanted to be. But maybe for a few months, I dreamed about becoming a professional tennis player. But I think I dreamed more about interesting places to travel. And now that I think about it, I did dream of going to the highest mountain in the world, to Mount Everest. But I do agree with Anna when she says,
you know, Marcia, childhood dreams are important.
And the dreams we have as adults are important as well. You can tell us about what you dreamed of doing when you were a child, or about your dreams as an adult, by writing to us at learningenglish@voanews.com or putting your comments under this video on YouTube.
And if you want another way to practice your English, just do an internet search of songs with the word dream in the title. You will probably find more songs than you could ever listen to.
That's because most of those songs are about love.
And that's a topic for another day. For now, we hope you've enjoyed today's lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast.
And you can learn more on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. You can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Thanks for listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.
Thank you.